Hello students, in this lecture I intend to discuss conditions liable and necessary for making the employer liable to pay compensation to the employees as stated in the Employees Compensation Act of 1923. As we know, Employees Compensation Act 1923 was the first attempt by the colonial government as regard the providing social security to the workmen is concerned. So in this lecture, we are going to discuss the conditions necessary for liability along with the doctrine of notional extension, which is a judicial extension of premises and which is an addition to the traditional notion that the employer will be liable to provide compensation only if the injury has taken place when the employee was within the precincts of the premises of the place of employment. Beside that, we shall discuss the doctrine of added peril, which provides a defenses to the employer when in a claim for compensation is being made by the employee. We shall discuss how to what extent the doctrine of added peril has been incorporated in section 3 of the Employees Compensation Act. Main features of Employees Compensation Act 1923. So Employees Compensation Act 1923 is a social security labor legislation. The act provides security from risk to the workmen in case of injury when the injury has arisen out of and in the course of employment. That is, the injury has some sort of relationship. And it is reasonably connected to employment. The act makes the employer an insurer of the workmen. It imposes a liability upon the employer to compensate employee in case of injury if it is proved that the injury was a result of or somehow connected to the employment. The liability is of the nature of no fault liability. Employee is not required to prove the negligence of the employer to claim compensation under this act. Liability in proportion to loss of earning capacity. As per the scheme of this act, the liability of the employer is proportional to the loss of earning capacity of employee. That is, what was the amount the employee was earning or capable of being earning at the date of injury has occurred, and after the injury, what is the proportion of reduction, what is the percentage of reduction in the earning capacity. The employer will be liable to pay compensation according to the formula as laid down in this act, which is in proportion to the consequent loss of earning capacity from the date of injury. The act establishes special machinery for deciding the claims under this act. It provides for the Office of Employees Compensation Commissioner. It excludes the civil courts, the jurisdiction of civil courts as regard the matters of compensation are concerned. The reason is that this procedure of the civil courts is dilatory. Civil courts have to follow an elaborate procedure. But if there is delay in payment of compensation, it will defeat the very purpose of this act. Limited scope. However, the scope of the Employees Compensation Act 1923, in the sense of the reliefs that it provides, is limited. It only provides for compensation to the employees in case of injury. It doesn't provide for old age pension, it doesn't provide for maternity relief, etc., which is provided for in a later statute known as Employees State Insurance Act of 1948, which deals with certain cash benefits to be provided to the employees in various circumstances such as maternity and injury, disablement, etc. Main features of Employees' Compensation Act 1923. So Employees' Compensation Act 1923 is a social security labor legislation. The act provides security from risk to the workman in case of injury when the injury has arisen out of and in the course of employment. That is, the injury has some sort of relationship, and it is reasonably connected to employment. The act makes the employer an insurer of the workman. It imposes a liability upon the employer to compensate employee in case of injury if it is proved that the injury was a result of or somehow connected to the employment. The liability is of the nature of no fault liability. Employee is not required to prove the negligence of the employer to claim compensation under this act. Liability in proportion to loss of earning capacity. As per the scheme of this act, the liability of the employer is proportional to the loss of earning capacity of employee. That is, what was the amount the employee was earning or capable of being earning at the date of injury has occurred, and after the injury, what is the proportion of reduction, what is the percentage of reduction in the earning capacity. The employer will be liable to pay compensation according to the formula as laid down in this act, which is in proportion to the consequent loss of earning capacity from the date of injury. The act establishes special machinery for deciding the claims under this act. It provides for the Office of Employees Compensation Commissioner. It excludes the civil courts, the jurisdiction of civil courts as regard the matters of compensation are concerned. The reason is that this procedure of the civil courts is dilatory. Civil courts have to follow an elaborate procedure. But if there is delay in payment of compensation, it will defeat the very purpose of this act. Limited scope. However, the scope of the Employees' Compensation Act 1923, in the sense of the reliefs that it provides, is limited. It only provides for compensation to the employees in case of injury. It doesn't provide for old age pension. It doesn't provide for maternity relief, etc., which is provided for in a later statute known as Employees State Insurance Act of 1948, which deals with certain cash benefits to be provided to the employees in various circumstances such as maternity and injury, disablement, etc. Conditions necessary for liability, Section 3, Clause 1. Section 3, Clause 1 of the Employees' Compensation Act 1923 lays down three conditions which are required to be fulfilled so that an employer is liable to pay compensation to the employee in case of injury. First condition is that employee should have suffered personal injury. Personal injury means injury to the body of the workman. However, it has also been held that nervous shock, which is caused to the workman by coming from hot room to the AC room and then vice versa, is a result of the employment, and therefore it is a personal injury. The incident which has caused the injury must be an accident. By the term accident, we means that any happening in which there is no human intervention. However, for the purpose of this act, courts have defined the term accident as some unforeseen event from the point of view of employee. Therefore, if a bomb blast takes place at the place of employment and injury is caused to the employee or he dies, courts have held that such incident will come within the term of accident and the employer will be liable. Why? Because it is an unforeseen incident so far as the employee is concerned. It is unforeseen incident from the point of view of employee. Third condition is that incident must have arisen out of and in the course of employment. The term arising out of refers to causal connection between the employment and the injury. It means that employment was the cause and injury was the effect. If such causal connection between employment and injury is proved, then we will say that injury has arisen out of employment. The term in the course of employment refers to time and place of employment. The injury should have occurred in order to make employer liable within the premises and during the period of employment, or it should be very close and proximate in time and place to the employment. There are certain diseases which are peculiar to a particular employment. Workers who are working in that particular employment and doing a particular job are most likely to get infected by that particular disease. So, Employees Compensation Act includes occupational disease in the definition of personal injury. That is injury, occupational disease, any disease which is peculiar to the employment and the employee who has worked for at least 6 months in the employment has contracted that particular disease is entitled to compensation under this act if he has infected by that particular disease. The list of occupational diseases has been given in the schedule of this act. Doctrine of notional extension of premises is an interpretation given to the expression arising out of in the course of employment by the judiciary. This covers those situations where an employee is outside the place of employment, but he is at the place which is reasonably connected with the employment. An employee may be at a place due to the employment. So, if an injury occurs to the workman at such place, whether or not he should be compensated by the employer or not, the answer to this question is yes, if the doctrine of notional extension of premises applies to such place. Generally, the doctrine is applied by courts when employee is coming from the place of employment and going from place of employment to his home, and he has reached such a place where he could not be but for the purpose of employment. General Manager Best versus Mrs. Agnes, AR 1964 SC 193 is an interesting case related to the doctrine of notional extension of premises. Now, what happened in this case? That there was an employee of Robest, that is Bombay state-run road transport corporation. He met with an accident when he was traveling by the bus after finishing his job and going to home. The rules of the Best provided that employee could travel in the bus, any of the bus of the fleet of the Best, after he has finished his employment. Although he could not sit, if he takes seat, he will have to pay the fare. Otherwise, he could travel without paying the fare. Question before the court was, what is the whether the bus of the transport corporation in which the person who is injured is himself a driver comes within the meaning of premises, for so as the doctrine of notional extension can be applied in his case. The court observed that though the doctrine of reasonable or notional extension of employment developed in the context of specific workshops, factories and harbors equally applied to the bus service, the court used the analogy of the workshop or factory to a bus and observed that the doctrine necessarily will be adapted to meet its peculiar requirements. While in the case of factory, the premises of the employer which gives ingress or egress to the factory is limited one, in the case of city road transport service, the entire fleet of buses forming the service would be premises, and hence the doctrine notional extension shall apply in such case. The proviso to section 3 clause 1 deals with the situation when employer is not liable in case of injury occurring to the employee even if the conditions stated above are fulfilled. It contains the doctrine of added peril to a limited extent. So, according to the doctrine of added peril, employer is not liable to pay compensation if employee has, by his act or omission, added to the inherent danger of employment. Every employment has a danger inherent into it. But employee sometimes, by doing certain act or omission, may add to the danger further than the natural or inherent danger. So logically, the employer should not be liable to compensate the workman in such case. The doctrine is to a limited extent applied in the proviso to section 3 clause 1 of Employees Compensation Act. It says that employer is not liable in respect of any injury which does not result in the death caused by accident which is directly attributable to, number one, the workman having been at the time thereof under the influence of drinks or drugs, willful disobedience of the workman to an order expressly given, to a rule expressly framed for the purpose of securing the safety of the workman, or willful removal or disregard of the workman of any safety guard or other device which he knew to have been provided for the purpose of securing the safety of the workman. Now, one thing is to be noticed here, that employer is not liable. Employer can take the defense only if the injury does not result in the death or permanent disablement. So these defenses can be taken only in case of partial disablement. Willful disobedience here means that employer should have may expressly ordered the employee to take precautions, and employee should have willfully defaulted. So if mere some commands are written on a wall, that will not be sufficient. What is required is that employer should command the employee to take the precautionary measures, and he should have expressly denied to take that measures. So these are some of the references for more extensive study of the topic by the student himself or herself. Some of the questions for self-appraisal by the students are given in this slide.